Somebody else.
I want God to use me where He wants me to be.
Amen.
So you're concerned about
being used by God. You want to be where He wants you to be. Give me two more. Yes, ma'am.
My children.
She's concerned about her children. Who else?
Just life. How would, you know, spend time out.
She's concerned about life and how it's going to play out. Give me two more. She's concerned about how good this topic is going to be. She knows something is coming. Who else? Yes? All right, let's leave it. Go ahead.
Praise the Lord. I'm concerned about my pastor when he says we're going to the next level. I'm concerned about that.
Amen. That's a topic that's, now I got a lot of hands. We're going to preach in a minute, y'all. Hold on.
Okay, I'm not concerned, but I'm excited about what God's going to do after we through after
he's
over with this consecration.
Amen. She's not concerned about it, but she's excited about what God is going to do after this 21-day consecration is over, which is January the what? 30th, right? Amen. So I wanted to do this. And the reason why I asked that question is because, as we all can see, every last one of us in here have some concerns. We're all concerned about something. Am I right? Every last one of us in here, we have something on our minds. Prior to me getting here, I'm not ever concerned about being able to deliver, I don't know half the time, what I'm going to deliver. Somebody say, really, Bishop? Sure. I don't know. Because a lot of times God gives and God sends. I'm just a sender, if you will. One that receives, one that sends. So I'm always concerned about that, right? So people have a lot of things on their minds. People are concerned about their finances. People are concerned about their children. They're concerned about their relationship with their spouses. They're concerned about whether or not they're going to make the grade to pass in life. As one young lady said, how life is going to play out. That is very uncertain. And so it causes us to have a lot of questions going on in our minds. Does that make sense?
Amen.
Well, don't think that you're by yourself.
Amen.
Because as we look at the 24th chapter of the book of Luke, the disciples of Jesus had a lot of things on their minds. So I want us to kind of walk through this for a moment. Because one of the issues that the church needs to begin understanding is her role and how we're called to help people to expand their mindsets from where they are to where He really wants them. The Bible declares, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind stayed on thee. So listen at this. So if we've been blessed, come on, y'all. If we've been blessed by God Himself to transform our minds from an earthly way of thinking to a spiritual way of thinking, don't you understand and realize that there are millions of people around us that would love to have that same mindset? But we are the ones that are called by God to carry out this mighty, powerful, explosive. exclusive assignment. Amen? Come on, give God a hand of praise. But the issue is, we have to get in place to help people expand their minds while they're minding certain things. How do we do that? Let's look at the scriptures. If you look at Luke 24, I just want to teach this morning, and look at verse number 36. The Bible says, "And as they thus spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said unto them, Peace be unto you." For those of you that are taking notes, because again, our objective is to help people with the things that they have on their minds. Now, here we find Jesus. And when the Bible says, when he enters in, he began to realize, first of all, when he entered in, he realized that they had something going on their mind. If he didn't realize that, there would be no reason for him to say, peace be unto you. So the issue is right here, they are in a very, very perplexing time in their lives. Why? Because the death, burial, and the resurrection has occurred. And now Jesus is trying to help them to become more established because of the relationship that he had prior to his resurrection. Amen? So how do we help people? See, what we're going to do this morning, we're going to glean from Jesus to see how he helped his disciples. Notice when he entered in. The right thing was on his mind, and therefore, when we enter into people's lives, the right thing needs to be on our minds, and our minds also need to be in the right frame. We need to have the right frame of mind when we enter into their lives. In other words, when Jesus went in, he didn't have a lot of stuff going on in his mind when he was about to help those who had trouble in their mind. And see, so oftentimes we think we are about to help somebody, but when our minds are troubled, how can you help somebody that's disturbed, perplexed, with a troubled mind, when your mind is already troubled? Does that make sense? And so the Bible said, when he entered in, as soon as he entered in, he knew that something was going on, because they realized that this is Jesus. Or could that really be Jesus? Because just like when we enter into people's lives, people are so disturbed. Is this the real thing? Or is it not the real thing? What is this? And so again, a lot of time we if the church would really understand what we've been called to do, we've been called to be Christ to people. However, so oftentimes we forget what we've been called to do, because we want Christ to be Christ for us. But here it is, these disciples are disturbed. How many people you know right now? In your life, your friends, your family members, those that you love, their minds are all over the place. Young people's minds are all over the place. They can't focus on anything at all because their minds are scattered. with the cares of this life, with things around them, things that are going on. Why my mama left me? Why my daddy left me? They're dealing with all kinds of things. Older people are concerned about, why did he leave? Why did I have to leave him? Why are we in this place? And they're trying to figure out life. I'm talking real. And people are dealing with this every single day of their life and trying to grab hold of something with some type of solidity. Something that's solid. The only thing that's solid is Jesus. Think about this. These are Jesus' disciples. These were men that were called by Jesus himself. And now he has to assure them that he is the one. Question. How many times have you tried to convince somebody else that don't know Jesus that Jesus is the one? And they doubt. And see, in this world today, when so many things are opposing Christianity, you got to know that the same thing that he dealt with, especially 2,000 some years ago, we are definitely going to deal with that today. Does that make sense? So now, and then think about it like this. If we are doubting, because a lot of times we doubt. Listen. If you doubt, that doesn't count you out. It didn't count the disciples out. God gave them another chance. Don't count yourself out. Amen? But when he entered in, his discernment was right. Does that make sense? The Bible says in verse 37 that they were terrified and affrighted and supposed that they had seen a spirit. Now again, the disciples were terrified. They didn't know who this was. What is going on here? Now he had already said that he was going to rise. But after it happened, they became, King James says, affrighted, afraid. Jesus came in his most purest form, and they were afraid of this situation. It lets us know something, church, that even when Jesus shows up for people in his most purest form, because of all of the things people done dealt with in life, because of all of the different challenges people had to deal with and continue to deal with every single day. Many people are still afraid. And they don't know if they can trust this Jesus or not. Because I've been let down so many times. I've been done wrong so many times. I don't know who to put my confidence in. After I put my confidence in that person, I found out that that same person that I put all of my confidence in let me down. And people today, church, are afraid. And the Bible says that fear is a torment. In other words, it affects your spirit so much so that when the real thing shows up, because you're so afraid to say, I got it finally, you will quickly find yourself releasing it, finding something else that is not sound, that's not solid, that's not sure, when you had the real thing. Yeah. And this is where people are. Young people are there, older people are there, middle-aged people are there. It makes no difference. People are there. And so you have to have a caring enough attitude about what people are going through. That you try your best to be as open and as transparent as you possibly can be, because somebody needs to believe that Jesus did rise. They can put their confidence in him. In verse number 38, it says, and he said to them, why are ye troubled and why do thoughts arise in your heart? There it is again. So now, if we're going to help people with the condition of their mind, we have to enter in the same way. Jesus asked the right questions. Why do doubts arise in your mind? Why are you troubled in your heart? He asked them the right questions. See, consultation is being able to discern where people are. Now, every time you counsel, doesn't mean that that person is going to share with you the exactness, if you will, of their heart. But being that you are the counselor, you need to know how to discern where they are. They never asked a question or they never made a statement. Jesus just knew where they were and he said, why are these thoughts going on in your mind? Why are you so troubled? Because the discerner discerns well. See, and this is the reason why the church needs to get herself in position. Who else can do this? As much as our young people love all these rappers and things like that, they cannot help you in your time of crisis. That's a good place to just give God a big old amen. But see, when somebody cares, why are you troubled in your heart? Why do you have all these thoughts going on in your mind? Yes. He entered in and he asked them not another question that they shouldn't receive, but he asked them the right question. Right. See, but see, your motive's got to be right when you interact with somebody. Your intentions must be correct when you're interacting with somebody, because everybody doesn't trust you and I enough to open up. You need to go in knowing where you are so they can begin exposing to you where they really are. Does that make sense, church? And this is so critical, especially in the hour in which we live. We have so many people confused right now. Young people, please turn your phones off. We have so many people that are confused right now until it is unreal. And it's because of all the noise. My God, don't we have some noise out here? So he said, listen to this. He said in verse number 39, he began to say, behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones as you see me have. I want to stop there. Write this down. In the process of questioning them, be real with them. See, when Jesus comes in, notice what he does. He says, guys, look, check out my hands. Check me out. In other words, what Jesus was saying, he said, now, because I'm a real person, And because I'm concerned about your real life and the questions that's going on in your life, the thoughts that's happening in your heart, all of the different situations that you may be mining right now, I want you to get close enough to me in order for you to really touch me. In other words, I'm genuine. I'm not some superficial person that can't be touched. I understand your pain. I understand your feelings. I understand that they left you, and I understand all the things that you're going through. I understand this. I'm real. I'm genuine. And so, church, as we begin to help people, because the church is designed to help people. In other words, it shouldn't be so much about us, our needs, our circumstances, our situation, after we've grown up a bit. We gotta help others to grow up. If we're not, what good are we to anyone? We have to be real to people. Jesus enters in and he says, you know what, touch me. You know, sometimes we are so untouchable. We don't want anyone to get close to us. Only people we allow in our lives are those that we are familiar with. We don't want anybody else to get in our what? Space. She said, no, I want you in my space. Because that's where I am. Jesus is, if these disciples of his were going to be the ones to continue the process and keep the process that he started going on and on and on, the first people that he began taking up time with after the resurrection is those disciples of his. He didn't deal with all the people that came to him after he had fed them with the 5 loaves and the 3 fish, praise the Lord, but he decided, amen, I'm going to take up time with these guys that walk closely with me. Sometime as a leader, you wish you could spread yourself around to touch everybody, but it is impossible. The needs of the people are too many. That's why the church has to play her part. The church needs to become more developed. The church needs to take this assignment on and be responsible for it. The church needs to do this. Does that make sense, church? Young people are hurting. Our young men need father figures. Our young ladies need mentors. Somebody got to assume the position. It can't be left to one person. It cannot be left to 2 people. The church needs to get herself in position. This is serious business, church. We are dealing with something right now in this 21st century that my mom, my dad, they never saw in their life. This is a critical, critical, critical time. That's not designed to scare you, that's designed to propel you. Jesus wanted to show them that, listen, I'm real. You know, we are pretty real in church. We put on a nice facade, take up time to look good, smell good, walk good, strut good. We do all that. But what happened when we walk out of those doors? When the real church needs to stand up. That's when it really matters the most. Because this is just like an educational facility. You come and get the information, and it is our job to spread it abroad. That's what this is all about. And this year, 2017, this year of expansion, everybody that's a part of Greater Harvest Church, prepare yourself to not only be inspired, but prepare yourself to be equipped and informed. Because you must have the Word of God in your heart, that you might not sin against God. Amen? Let's give our God a hand of praise right there. So we have to be real with them, church. Number four. Look at verse number 42 through verse number 43. The Bible says, let me go back. Again, if you look at 40, he said, look, guys, check my feet out. And then look at verse number 42, because this is important. He says, and they gave him, because he asked him the question, is there any meat around here? The Bible says, and they gave him what? Raw fish. Here is point number four. Allow people to serve you when they open up to you. Amen. See, the thing is, now I have an issue with this. Because sometimes, I'm going to be honest with you, sometimes I'm so used to serving. When people want to serve me, oh God, y'all, great. Anybody that's been around Great Hall of Church knows I have a problem with that. But Jesus opened himself up for them to serve him. Amen. They gave him broiled fish. Did y'all see that? Amen. So in the relationship building process, because he was so concerned about keeping their relationship together and alive, he sat down and allowed them to serve him. Somebody say, that's fellowship. Could you imagine if after they opened up to Jesus, and he asked them the question, is there any meat around here? And they said, yeah, we got some. Here's a piece of raw fish. Oh, I don't want that stuff. Now that would have been very what? Offensive. And so sometimes I'm guilty. I'm just letting you know, sometimes when people want to serve me after they open up to me, and sometimes I say, well, you know what? I don't need that. I'm good.
Amen. Amen.
No, I could do better than that.
Amen.
I got to open up to people
that
have what? Opened up to me. I'm just telling you the truth. And see, because the Lord, we hadn't gotten to where he wanted to take us yet. He's on a mission. He's always on an assignment. And he also wants us to have that same kind of mindset so that we can be on that same kind of an assignment. Does it make sense? And see, that's why our minds, church, got to be so in sync to what God is doing now.
That's right.
So we can be a blessing to people now and later.
Amen.
Does it make sense?
Yes.
So again, he tells them, he said, look, guys, is there any meat? They give him the meat, and they also give him honeycomb. Looked like Jesus was kind of, I'm just moving off now, but I'll come back. But he looked like he was concerned about what he put in his body. He wasn't about to destroy this temple of his, right? You don't see that he had pig lips and I just had a great job that day. Intestines and things of that nature. No, give me some fish. Give me some honeycomb. It worked. Thank you, Jesus. But see, the thing is that he allowed people to serve him. See, the scripture, I love this. This is my most favorite scripture. For the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and give his life as a ransom for many.
Yes, Lord.
So leaders don't look to be served.
Amen.
Leaders are conditioned to serve.
Yes, Lord.
And that's why when it's time for us to receive service, sometimes we can be very apprehensive of that service that somebody want to give.
Amen. Yes,
sir.
Amen.
So all of our minds have to be what? Renewed. Someone say, my mind.
My mind.
Someone say, my mind.
My mind.
Needs to be renewed.
Thank you, Lord.
It has to be renewed. The Bible said he took it and did eat. He did it not out, you know, he didn't take his food and put it in a box and say, I'm going to go home. I'll eat it when I get home. Y'all know what happened when those boxes go home. Don't you sit the bride. I'm not saying that you're just you now. But y'all know when we get those plates that they just prepared for us and we take them home. Something happened to that box. All that food, minister. It took all that time up to prepare that box and now here we are and take, I'll give me mine to go. He said, you know what? I'm going to just stop right here and I'm going to eat it before you. As a matter of fact, I want you guys to sit down with me while I'm eating. Because I want to be in a relationship with you guys. And I want you to know that I'm really concerned about not where you are currently, but I'm concerned about where you're going when it comes to your future. Because I have my destination. He knows where he's going. The Bible said, if you look in the book of Acts, the first chapter, I'm not saying that you need to turn there, but in your time of study, he stayed on the face of this earth for 40 days, showing himself to people after he rose. Because he wanted people to know that, listen, I am the resurrection. I am the life. Though I was dead, I am going to continue living again.
Yes.
Trust me. Yes. Amen?
Amen?
So he ate this in front of church. Listen here. One of the best ways, especially when we talk about leaders and those of you that are maturing in the faith, one of the best things you can do is take up time, sit down and dine with people. I enjoyed last year several times I had the opportunity to just sit down with a few of the younger guys and the teenagers because I feel like I'm able to pour something into their lives. Something that's positive. Something that's going to last even after I'm gone. I don't want to just pour something into them temporarily. Some trend, but I want something that they can take from me, my life, and live it out every single day. Y'all remember a few years, that young lady right there, I looked like a fool on the football field. twisting and turning around because a young lady asked me to dance with her on the football field during halftime. All over the place. Because, oh my God, I was struggling. But we made it, didn't we make it? We made it. Because we need people to know that we're real. It's important. It's real important. Because if you can make an impact or an imprint in the life of one young person, trust me, it has lifelong lasting effects. And that's what the church is all about. That's what it's all about. It can't be about anything else. It must be about people and their lives that they're living and where they are going. And we must do our best job to model Christianity, which is hope, in a world where there is no hope. We have to, church. And everybody needs to decide that, you know, early this year, 2017, sign me up. Because I want to be counted amongst the living, not the dead. If Christ has made us alive, give somebody else life. That's our job. Five. Look at verse 145. It says, then open he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures. When your mind has expanded, give people the word of God. It will expand their minds also. See, his mind was open. He knew where he was every moment, every chance. I mean, he knew exactly where he was. But look at how he led them to where he wanted to go and where he's trying to take them. It was orderly. It was done, I would say, in style. He knew the direction. He knew what he wanted to get across to them and how effective he wanted to make it happen. And then how effective they would be as they continued the process. So the Bible says, and he opened the scriptures unto them. Prior to that, they would have been closed to the word. See, sometimes we think that, you know, just because they come to church or whatever, just because, you know, they've been in our little circle or whatever, why they didn't get it? Why they didn't get the word? Oh, yeah. People are afraid of us. Every last one of us. Because we're all uniquely made.
That's it.
Let me back up. Uniquely and fearfully made. That means when the Lord made us, he was like, oh my goodness, what in the world did I just make? Because I know that same one that I just made will turn their back on me. We're wonderfully and fearfully made. So, church, as we accomplish the assignment, we have to do it based on the word of God. Yes. God said, now listen here, if you're going to be one of mine, the bottom line is walk them through the process.
That's it.
And get them to the place where we can now open unto them the scriptures. Yes. Because if anything gonna change, it's not gonna be a meal. Y'all know that's gonna go in one way. But the word of God is everlasting. The word of God is forever settled in heaven. The word of God shall never leave. The word of God, that's the only thing. So when he got them to that place where they can understand the scriptures, then he can let them know without a doubt, listen here guys, I got a mission for you all. You all are witnesses of these things. Now let me inform you that this gospel that you've just heard will begin in Jerusalem. I want you to begin preparing yourself for it, because I am going to send the promise of my Father to you. The Comforter will come. I'm letting you know without a doubt that it's going to happen. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. You got to prepare yourself for this, Tony. It doesn't happen automatically. You got to prepare yourself for this. When you go over to Jerusalem, just sit there, be in prayer, waiting, 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 until the promise of my Father comes. It will happen. Praise the Lord. When they understood these things, then they were ready to do the call that God had assigned to their lives. My question to Greater Harvest Church this morning is, how about you, Greater Harvest? Are you prepared to meet up to the make and matchmaker? Praise the Lord. Are you ready to do what he has called you to do? Amen. Every last one of us in here has an assignment that God has given us. Praise the Lord. It is up to you to assume that position. It's up to you and I to assume that assignment. We cannot believe that somebody else is going to take ownership and responsibility of this. This has been given to us. Praise the Lord. This has been given to you. It has been given to myself. Amen. We have to decide that, you know what, I want to open up my mind so that I can help somebody else open their minds up as well. Come on, y'all. Praise the Lord. You got to open up somebody's mind today. Too many people's minds are closed. Praise the Lord. You got to decide that, you know what, no matter what goes or what comes, amen, I'm going to have an open mind to whatever God is doing in this time. I don't want to be closed-minded. Praise the Lord. God needs me to open up my mind. Ask someone next to you, is your mind open yet? Praise the Lord. Do God need to come down, him himself, amen, and pull the lid off of your mind? Open up your mind, church. God got great things in store for every last one of us. Are y'all here? Praise the Lord. Ask the neighbor, are you ready to receive it right now? Praise God. Jesus got men in position. He said, now if you get in place, praise God, I'm going to use you all to turn your city upside down. Are y'all here? Praise the Lord. Do you understand that God has placed us in this season, in this city? Praise the Lord for this time. Every last one of us in here, praise God, we got something God want to do in our lives. Let's do it, church. God the glory. Let's do it. Why not do it? Tell somebody, why not do it? Come on, y'all. Why not do it? Praise the Lord. I may as well do what God wants me to do. Other people are doing what God wants them to do. I may as well do what he wants me to do. Why not? Why not? I'm not too young. I'm not too old. Praise the Lord. I am who God has made me to be. Somebody's mind is closed. Children today, do you all believe that just while we are here right now, a young man died?
Yes, yes. My God, my God.
Well, y'all don't believe me.
My God, my God.
Without hope in Christ, do y'all know how quick a person died from the face of this earth?
Lord Jesus.
People leave here in the thousands every second of the day. Just like mothers are bringing forth children every single day. I'm talking about young people, older people, every single day. Thousands are leaving here every single second. Do your research. And I know sometimes we think that we have a long period of time to live. Do y'all understand? This is a short life. That's why James said, life is as of but a vapor. It appeared for a moment and it vanisheth away. It's not long. Can't believe I've been here 54 years and counting. Every single day, every moment of the day, I mean, the clock is moving, the clock is ticking. My time is getting closer and closer. Your time is getting closer and closer. Our time is getting closer and closer to getting out of here.
Yes, sir.
We better wake up, church. For tomorrow's not promised to us. Whatever we're going to do for Jesus, we better do it today. Amen? Everyone standing, please. Tell somebody, I have an assignment upon my life. Tell somebody, I am a mind-opening man. I'm a mind-opening woman. I have an assignment upon my life. Ask someone next to you, can I help you open up your mind? Well, Jesus has given us the tools. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, and we will have our minds open. Come on, give God a hand of praise up in this place.